Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome back to Down to Earth Astronomy. Very recently, the comet with the easy-to-remember name, C2020F3, that was the name, right? has been passing close by Earth, and I managed to go out, get a few shots of it, and I also got a few shots of the moon while I was out there, because it was pretty good that night. And today, I'm going to show you a image processing method called Locky Imaging, which is one of my personal favorite image processing methods. But first, I just want to quickly show you the gear that I've been using, and I've kept it very, very simple. I have a tripod, as you can see here. Simple tripod, nothing fancy, with a small quick release on the top. Very compact. I mean, you can just put this in a backpack or just take it with you by hand. Weighs nothing and takes no time at all to set up. For the lens, I didn't bring an actual telescope. So I just brought this, which is a zoom lens. I really like this because it's nice and compact. Now it doesn't give me, if we open this up here, you can see the light collection area is not the biggest in the world, but it's big enough, it's bigger than just what you would get on a normal lens, and it's big enough that you can get some decent shots. Now, I am doing this in the middle of Copenhagen, so light pollution is a real thing. So we're not expecting the best pictures, but again, with the whole mantra of keeping this thing light. And you can really get far with just having a good zoom lens to put on a DSLR. Now, obviously the camera, I can't show you that because I'm recording on it right now. But the other thing that's probably the most important thing is this little fella here. This is basically a release for the camera. Plug that thing into the camera, and then you can use this to basically trigger the camera. This is nice because that means you can trigger the camera without touching it. Just the slightest touches to the camera, just you walking around the camera, is enough for it to shake in and you get blurry pictures. So having a remote trigger like this, even though this is on a wire, that's fine, but having a remote trigger like this is really nice. This one's particularly I really like because you can push and then slide it up, then it locks the trigger in, meaning if I want to do continuous shooting, if I just want to do multiple frames, then I can just lock it in, leave that thing hanging underneath the camera, and it will just keep taking pictures after pictures. Let's head into the computer and let's have a look at some of the pictures. So this is one of the raw pictures, completely unprocessed, that I took of the comet. We can see it here if we zoom in a bit. A little grainy and not that much tail visible, but we're going to be playing around with it and we're going to see what we can get out of it. I'm also just quickly going to find one of the moon pictures. Not the highest detail, this is actually quite shaken. You can see there's quite a bit of blur in this, and we're going to see if we can't improve that a little bit. But what I basically have done, as you can see, I've taken a ton of pictures and they're all pretty much identical. As you can see, as I'm scrolling through them, it's pretty much just the same picture with relatively short exposures, in case with the moon at least. If we go in here, we should be able to have that information. So you can see I ran with a ISO 400, 1/50th exposure with a, here's my f-stop if you're interested, and you can also see my focal length. Everything is actually saved in here in the metadata, so you can see that. Now there's a whole plethora of different softwares that you can be using for this. Right here I'm using one that's called Deep Sky Stacker, and I've also been playing around with one that's called AVI Stack, and one that's called Auto Stacker. All free tools that you can get, they all do the same thing. They take many, many pictures and they stack them on top of each other, which we're going to do now. In case with the comets, let's start by just go up here, and we're going to go and we're going to open up our imaging files. So here we have all the files. I've just had the first one open. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to make sure they're all selected by just clicking Select All, and we're going to go Register Checked Pictures. Registering is basically when it detects which frames are the most sharp and which are the most blurry, and they're getting a score. You can see these are actually already scored because I have done some processing on these already, you know, just for fun. But we can go here and we can say, okay, after they're registered, we want to stack and we want to use the 80% best. So it's taking the 20% worst pictures, they're being disregarded. So if you had something where it was very shaky or it was really blurry at the time, you can see here in this red box, it says, I haven't uploaded any dark frames, flat fields or bias frames to offset or to kind of calibrate for the camera. And if you wonder what those type of frames are, I have a video about it, which you can go and you can watch up here in the more info icon. But in here we have tons and tons of settings about the whole stacking. For instance, we can say, do we want to have basically like a frame
that just centers on the object? Do we want a mosaic where it kind of stacks it up to a whole mosaic, or do we want to just to have the overlapping area? I've gone for just the overlapping area because that's probably easier. And the camera was relatively steady and there's very short exposure, so that should be just fine. We get the comet in like in the full frame. But if you're taking, if you zoomed in a lot on that object, you're taking many frames, you could like just do a mosaic here. We control a lot of different things in here. I'm not going to go into detail with this, but there's a lot of settings about how you want to stack, what method you want to stack. And there's one thing that's actually pretty fun that's in here where you go star detection, because it needs alignment points. And if I go here and I click compute number of stars, you can see it detected 13 stars in the picture, and it will use those 13 stars as alignment points. So try to stack or rotate and like pull and twist the pictures until all those 13 stars are in the same location in the images to make sure that it compensates for the object moving as you take pictures if you don't have tracking or something like that. It's pretty fun, pretty neat. But yeah, I'm just going to click OK here. We get an overview. You can see here it does tall it up to like 1.5 minutes of total exposure for all the different frames. Now, just like any good cooking program, I have, of course, prepared a little bit from home. And you can see I've already created the autosave file here, the autosave TIFF file, which is the finished stacked file. I'm just going to show you the difference here. You can also notice here it's a big file. It's 1 gigabyte images. This is a single image file. It's 1 gigabyte. It's absolutely massive. But here I have one of the original frames. And behind me here in GIMP, I have the finished stacked frames. Let's just see if we can zoom in a bit here so we can kind of see the difference. You can see that it managed to pull out quite a bit more tail, and in general it seems to be just a little bit more detailed. You can kind of begin to see some of the effects of the tail as it comes off the comet, and in general it just looks a lot better. Of course we can do a lot of more processing on it, and this is of course why I have GIMP opened. I'm not going to do a tutorial on how to do like picture editing in GIMP today, but one of my favorite tools is to go in here, and you can see most of our pictures down here in the darker end of the picture. So if you put up a split frame here, put that around there, zoom in a bit, then we can begin and simply say, okay, there's nothing down there, so just by pulling this up to maybe around it looks about good. We can see we did lose a little bit, but already it's a lot darker. We got rid quite a bit of that noise, and we can just keep on playing around with this until we get something that we're happy with. Okay, so this is where it was after we stacked, and this is what I got out of it afterwards. Now we can actually see, notice how dark the picture is here at the top and how light it is down here at the bottom. That's light pollution for you right there. That is pure light pollution. I didn't have a light pollution filter or anything on in this case, so that's why we have that in the picture. And even though the background is not as dark, I kind of like that you can get this bluish hue, and the gradient from the light at the bottom to the dark at the top kind of looks good. And just look how much more tail we managed to get out of this. And if we even go back and we compare to one of the original frames that we had here, it's just a completely different picture, right? So this is where we started, and this is where we're at now. It's just not even comparable how much more we managed to get out of that. And I'm actually pretty pleased with this. So I want to do something similar with the moon pictures, and just to remind ourselves, just open up a random one and see this is kind of what we're working with at the moment. It's okay, we can see craters. It's a little blurry and there's not a ton of detail in there, but it's there and it's definitely the moon. Now, just for fun, I'm going to try to use auto stack at this time, just to try something different. It's a little bit more manual tool than Deep Sky Stacker, but it definitely works. So we're basically just going to go ahead and to select all our image files in here, like so. Okay, so I've been playing around with the alignment for a bit. You can basically choose surface or planet up here, depending on what it is. And ideally, I should use surface, but I got a better alignment with planet, and where I manually set the alignment points, you can see I set them here. All these red dots with squares around them are my alignment points that I set along the edge where it's, and along like very prominent features is often where it's best to put these. So I put all those up there so we kind of hopefully get something that's similar. And we got a quality graph here So we can see we're gonna, I said it was to 85%. That's about there with the, with that drop off. So we take those last pictures and we skip those. And then it's just about going ahead and click stack. And then you wait. And you wait again. And this is gonna get gonna take a bit of time. And after a little bit of waiting, it is now done. And actually, let's just go back and start by just open up like random one of the frames that we had. And let's zoom in so we have this nice and big like that. And then let's take our finished processed frame. And let's see what it comes up with here. It is, once again, quite a big file. This is 350 megabytes, so it's probably gonna give that some time to load. And here we have the two results side by side. You can see from it actually being slightly overexposed, it's trying to compensate for that. And you look at the edge of the craters, they're now a lot better defined, a lot clearer to look at. And after a little bit of color correction to compensate for the fact that this looks very yellow because the moon was very low on the horizon, so you get a very yellow glow for it. So I try to compensate for it, making giving it a more natural, maybe slightly too blue hue, but I really like this blue issue when it comes to moon shots. And it's just, I mean, it, this is not even the same pictures. We went from something that looked like this that came straight out of the camera to something like this after a little bit of processing. Now, I really hope that this will encourage more of you guys to go out and try this for yourself. And as again, this image processing, this is not difficult. It might seem like black magic what's happening, and to a large degree, it is. With a few helpful YouTube videos that maybe go into a little bit more depth with whatever program you end up using, which one you like the most, well, you can get quite far. You can get some pretty neat shots. I mean, and if I could get pictures like this in the middle of Copenhagen with a lens that could almost fit in my pocket, imagine what you can get if you go out to a nice dark area with no light pollution and with a proper telescope with a lot larger light collection area. You can get some amazing shots, trust me. Thanks a lot for watching. Hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, give a like, subscribe, and until next time, I'll see you guys in space.